Good morning or good afternoon, everyone. So welcome to the next session of the Altair Simulation and Student Webinar Series. As you have seen yesterday, we have quite some more topics to cover concerning simulation and structural mechanics. And yeah, today we are going to cover some more topics, some more advanced topics for you. So about myself, my name is Jan. I work at Altair since 2010 as an account manager for academics. So my task is basically to reach out to students, to professors, to anyone who would like to use our software. And today with me is again Marius, as yesterday, who will now give an introduction into various simulation topics concerning mainly composite and laminate simulation. As usual, you can you can post your questions in the question tab of the GoToWebinar session. We will be happy to answer them either in written form or in a short break. So feel free to give us your questions related to the presentation. And you can also post general questions, of course. Our demo recordings of today and the model files will be made available again on YouTube. So you can go to the registration page where you registered for the webinar and find the link to the YouTube page there. Or you can go directly to YouTube, type in Altair University channel or Altair University, and you'll find all the recordings on our channel there as well. All right. For the agenda of today, it's mainly about composite optimization and composite simulation. So, for example, if you are working in a student team and you want to design a monocoque, this is usually done nowadays by laminating fibers with a resin and basically put them together in order to put strength in material in the directions or at the places where you need it. And the question is, how can you design the laminate layup, the laminate shapes, the laminate directions? And for this, simulation can be a help. So, for example, here of the student team of our university in Stuttgart, they did this 2 years ago with basically using Altair HyperWorks to determine the layup sequence and layup directions of their composite structure. And this is the focus of today, how you can use simulation to perform tasks similar to this one. So I think in many projects that you have as a student team, you are often asked to do lightweight or material or mass-saving constructions. And for this, I think laminates are a very, very important topic. So let's get started then with Marius as a speaker today. He'll give you an introduction into composite modeling and simulation based on a plate model, so quite a simple getting started model, but it's really good to understand the different steps that are needed. And once this is done, you can use again optimization algorithms to determine the optimized shape and optimized ply angles of your laminates. And Marius will show that in the second session with a laminated profile. All right, so I hope you enjoy the sessions, and now let's listen to Marius. And as usual, if you have questions, feel free to type them in the question tab.
Hello and welcome to the Altair Student Webinar Series to the part of design composite structures with simulation. So that you know who's talking to you, I want to shortly introduce myself to you. My name is Marius Müller. I'm Altair Ambassador since 2018. I am holding a bachelor degree in mechanical engineering from Graz University of Technology in Austria. I am FEA consultant of Tier Graz Racing Team, is a student team which is participating in Formula Student. Furthermore, I am former team principal of Terra Tio Graz, a team that participates in Shell Eco Marathon. Next to that, I'm part-time project collaborator at the Institute of Material Science, joining and forming at the working group Tooth and Forming at Graz University of Technology. Last but not least, and I'm really happy about it, I'm FEA engineer at PJ Messtechnik GmbH. PJM is a worldwide leading specialist in the field of railway system. The Austrian company was founded in 2006 and has successfully realized projects in 30 countries and 5 continents. We have about 60 employees at the Graz site to ensure 100% made in Austria. The company is divided in PJ Messtechnik and PJ Monitoring. PJ Messtechnik is an accredited test center by ISO IEC 17025 standard, focusing on approval tests for railway vehicles, like the suburban railway in Berlin, for example. PJ Monitoring is a technological leader in automation and digital systems for rail freight transport. Before we start with the topics, I want to shortly go through the agenda with you. Today we will deal with 2D meshing, then we head over to modeling composites, and then we will answer the question what actually optimization is. And at the end of the day, we will do composite optimization. Before we start modeling the composite plate, I would just like to tell you a bit about composites itself. A composite material is a material which is produced from two or more constituent materials. A really well-known example for this are the fiber-reinforced plastics, which are shown here on this slide. Basically, you put fibers and matrix together and you form a ply. If you put more than one ply on top of each other, you form a laminate. And if you put these plies with an angle to each other, on top of each other, you also have to consider a reference orientation. In the following minutes, I will tell you how to design or how to model composites with OptiStruct. We will take this metal plate example from before and just delete material and properties and define our composite properties on this plate. All right, back in HyperMesh, the first thing we have to do is to save our model, this metal sheet model. To do so, you just can click here on File, Save, and then your metal plate should be saved if you have saved it before already. Now, the next step is to make a copy of this HyperWorks database and create a composite plate out of this metal plate. To do so, just click here on File and say Save As. You want to save it as HyperMesh model. You save it where you want to save it, and I save it as composite plate. And then your file has been saved. It's written down here. Now we should delete materials and properties we have defined in the metal plate tutorial. So I just go here on material in my model browser, click here Matalu, and just click delete on my keyboard. And this material should be deleted. Second thing I have to delete is this property. You can again delete it by just clicking delete on your keyboard, or you hit right mouse button and say delete here. So now we have the mesh defined. We still have our load collectors and our load step. The next thing we have to define is then again an material. In the metal plate tutorial, we defined aluminium material. This is can basically treat it like an isotropic material. So we have property, material properties, In all three directions are the same, or in all directions are the same, and now we are going to create orthotropic materials because if you think of it, ply or laminate is basically an orthotropic material. You can see it as an orthotropic material, or you can see it as a material with an orthotropic material behavior. So I want to give you a basic guideline of how to deal with composite structures in HyperWorks and OptiStruct. A really good thing to keep in mind is that you can basically control everything via this composite browser. If you click here on model and the title bar and here on composites, you will see that your composite browser will open. First thing you have to check when you're dealing with composites is the element normal direction. I've shown it to you a few minutes ago, but now I want to show you another way how to display element normals. As I said, this composite browser is now really important for us. So you just can right click here and say orient, and then you click on element normal. Then this orientation review window will open, and you just select elements in your graphic area, hit OK, and say apply. Elements, I have to select them and hit apply. Display color, apply. Now it's working, yeah? And vector, apply. Okay, the vector is just so small. 10. Good, now we have it, yeah? Of course, we don't have to change the element normal direction since this is still our metal plate or the definition of the metal plate. I just wanted to show you how you can check the element normal direction with this composite browser tool. Perfect. I just go back to this top projection. And then, as said in the introduction, the next thing we have to check is the material reference orientation. The material reference orientation establishes a reference for ply angles and so for fiber orientation. The fiber orientation itself is essential for the physical properties of composite materials. For example, you have the E-modulus 1 and the E-modulus 2, and the E-modulus 1 corresponds to the E-modulus of the ply in the fiber direction, and E-modulus 2 corresponds to the E-modulus of the ply perpendicular to the fiber direction. To check how, or by default in OptiStruct, the material reference orientation is the element orientation. To check this, you can make use of this tool here in Elements, in this normal ribbon, and up here you have the lens. If your element orientations, you can click on here, and then this orientation review window will open again, and you will be directed to this elemental system tab. You can just select elements in your graphic area, hit OK, and if you click on apply, you will see that you basically have an X and a Y direction for your elemental system, and you can see that your coordinate system, your end element systems differ from element to element. In order to define plies in a proper way, you have to make all, or you have to define a material reference orientation, which is pointing in one direction, and then you tell OptiStruct that your plies are orientated with an angle from this material reference orientation. Since it's a lot of work to change the elemental system because the elemental system is strongly dependent on the node numbering of each element, we are going to create a local coordinate system and define this material reference orientation I told you about. So I'm going to close this orientation review. I'm going to I'm going to model. And here on model, you have the systems. This is basically used to create and assign systems, so local coordinate systems. If you click on here, this systems panel will open. And there you already can see that you have several options to create systems. You can create it by axis direction or by node reference. I'm going to use create by axis direction. And then I'm just going here to origin, define my origin here. I'm defining the x-axis of my local coordinate system here. And I'm defining the y-axis up here in this corner. As you can, or as you might have noticed, is that I'm basically using the global coordinate system also for the local coordinate system. This is just because I want to show you this tool. You also can, of course, define your x-axis, for example, in this direction, and then your Y orientations would be from this axis here, if you define it like this. For creating local coordinate systems, it's really important that you are using geometry corner data for the points, because we have this meshing algorithm in HyperMesh, and it can be that if you're, for example, choosing this point, and this node here, sorry, these are nodes, not points. So if you're choosing this node, and this node here, that this is not totally the x-axis, the global x-axis, because of the meshing algorithm. So I would suggest that you just define it at geometry corners. If you hit on create, you see in your composite browser that a system collector was created. And if you open this, you get your coordinate system, which is at the moment called Auto1. The system collector is the same as a load collector or components, but instead of saving elements, geometries, or loads or single point constraints in a collector, the system collector saves local coordinate systems. What else is important here in this relative size? You, for example, can just fix the size of this coordinate system, how you can to better see it basically. And what's also important is we created a rectangular coordinate system, but it's also possible to create cylindrical or spherical coordinate systems. Just that you also know that. Then I'm going to hit return here. I'm changing the color of this coordinate system to something I can actually see, maybe this red here. And then I'm going to have a look at my material orientation now. For that, I have to go to this composite browser again, hit right-click, orient, and here you can see this material reference orientation. Again, this is done by right-clicking in this composite browser, and here material orientation. Here you can choose the elements you want to orientate in a specific direction. I'm choosing all elements of this plate. Hit OK. X direction method, here you can change to curve. This I will show you later on in the optimization example. You can say system ID or system axis. I'm going for system ID since I have a system with ID 1. So I'm choosing system ID. Click here on system, choose this system over here. Exactly. And hit OK. And then I click on apply. And automatically you will see that you get these arrows in on your play elements. And you see all arrows are pointing in the same direction. So by default, if you choose a local coordinate system as material reference orientation, the And you say X-direction method, it's even here in this name already. Hyperworks is taking the x-axis of this local coordinate system to define your material reference orientation. What does that mean now? If we define Bliess later on, our Bliess angle will be defined from this reference orientation by following the right-hand rule. So x is pointing to my right. And that's if you apply the right-hand rule and y is pointing up, your Bliess will be orientated. For example, if you put 45 degrees, you will get a fiber one direction of this here for this Bliess with 45 degrees Bliess orientation defined. I click on cancel because our material orientation is now defined. Maybe I give a nice name to my system. I just say this is my system, not orient. The next thing we can do is defining our orthotropic material. For normal or for isotropic materials, you would use this materials ribbon. But for composites, there's a faster way to create materials. You just can right-click here in the composite browser, say create, and here on material, you can click material to create a material. If I just make this entity browser a bit bigger, you can see that automatically a card image of MUT8 was created. MUT8 is the card image for orthotropic materials. And as I said, OptiStock by default automatically creates or Hyperworks by default automatically creates this kind of material cards or material image for the selected solver here. Since we are in OptiStruct, MUT8 will automatically be selected. What does that mean? That means that we can define in an E-modulus in the fiber direction. If it can define an E-modulus perpendicular to the fiber direction, we can define a Poisson ratio and shear moduluses as well as the density. Furthermore, and this is also really nice, we can define allowable stress and strain limits in the longitudinal and lateral directions. These limits are then used to define or to request a material failure, basically a first play failure. These are theories. For example, one of the first play failures is the maximum strain theory. There you say, okay, my strains in my model are, for example, I only allow maximum strains of 0.5% in my model, for example. And if you have a complex geometry and many, many plies, you would get a failure index for every of these for every of those plies you have defined on your laminate. If you're using this and requesting the results then later on in the optimization requests. We will use these values here in the optimization tutorial later on. For now, I just leave them blank and I define my material here. I want to have an E-modulus in fiber direction of 110,000 megapascals and perpendicular to this direction, I want to have 8,500. I want a Poisson ratio of 0.3 and all I define now is a shear modulus of 4,000 in direction 1, 2. And I also can define density of 1.7 times 10 to the power of minus 9 tons per cubic millimeters. Perfect. So our material was defined. So before we go to creation of plies and laminates, I just want to repeat again what I told you before about material reference orientation and ply orientation. The material reference orientation is just an orientation, measured from the element x direction. As you can remember, we had our element system, and on this element system, we just said, okay, I want to have material reference orientation, and this is this angle theta here. If we are going now over to Bly creation, OptiStruct will ask us about the one nominal fiber direction. So in the Bly creation, we tell OptiStruct, okay, my Bly has an angle of 45 degrees, for example. This is this theta k. This is an orientation on top of the first orientation here. And then, for example, if you do draping simulation, you can add another angle on your to get this total angle, which is your actual fiber one direction. Okay, let's go back to HyperMesh and define and create our plies. To create plies, the first thing we have to do is to create shapes. Shapes are basically it's already in the name, the shape of your ply. In our case, I want to take the whole plate as one shape. So my plies would look like this, what you can see here, just a rectangular shape. To create shapes, we are again using this composite browser, right click in here, say create and say shape. And then you see under the shapes, one set will be created. This is an element set, so we are saving those elements here which are defining our shape into the set, and this set is then in the next step assigned to our plies. So I'm going to entity IDs, click here on elements, choose all elements in my graphic area and say okay. You can see we have 300 elements in our model, and those 300 elements are now saved in our element set, in which is defining the shape. I just will rename my shape to shape full, because this shape is containing all elements. That's the reason for the name full. Perfect. Then to create a ply, it's again this right click in the composite browser saying create, and this time we are going to create a ply. If you click here on ply, you will see that in this composite browser, you have the most important information about the ply already saved or already displayed in the browser itself. So we have now an unstacked ply. This is because this ply is not part of a laminate yet. We have ply ID, okay, ply ID is 1, orientation is 0 degrees. So our fiber 1 direction is pointing in the x direction. If we change this to 90 degrees, for example, our fiber 1 direction will be pointing to in direction of this y axis here. Important because, as you remember, we defined material properties depending on our ply, on the fiber directions. Good, then we can assign a thickness, a material, and a shape. You can change orientation or thickness here in this composite browser directly. I want to have a ply thickness of 0.2 millimeters. And if I want to change the material, I can just come here down and choose my material I've created before. It's material one in this case. I don't have any drape, so I don't have any drape table, so I can go over to shape. I am selecting my shape here, shape full, and click OK. And that's basically it. So you see in the composite browser, you have now orientation 0 degree, thickness 0.2 millimeters, material 1, and shape full. In order to create a laminate, we have to define several plies. And I would like to have a laminate with a total thickness of 2 millimeters. That would mean I have to create 9 more plies, all with the same orientation and the thickness of 0.2 millimeters to achieve 10 plies at the end, which make a total laminate thickness of 2 millimeters. Because this is a lot of work, you can just here go to ply with the right mouse button and say you want to duplicate this this ply. Duplicate, you can see here, it's the first option. And then you can define a prefix name and how many plies you want to duplicate from this ply. I would just say, okay, it should be ply, my prefix name, and then I want to create 9 more plies. And as you can see, automatically you get 9 more plies and all with the same or properties like the first ply. In order to make use of the visualization tools, I will show you later on. It's beneficial for it's beneficial to use different ply colors for different plies. I will go and define all plies with an uneven number, with a color maybe blue, and all the other plies can I want to have them with a darker color, maybe like this one here. Yeah, okay, now we have 10 unstacked plies, and the next step is to create a laminate. As said before, these plies are now stacked in direction of the element normal direction. And in order to create a laminate, I will just make this entity browser a bit smaller. In order to create a laminate, you can just right click again in the composite browser and say you want to create a laminate. You just click enter. And then you can just drag and drop those unstacked plies. If you select all of them, you just drag and drop them into the laminate. You see these plies are not unstacked anymore. They are now here in this laminate. If you want to change the order, you just take, for example, ply 5 and drag and drop it on ply 1, and you see that ply 5 will be now in front of ply 1. Or you make it back, this you undo it, or basically you can also drag and drop 3 plies at one time, for example, something like this. This is a really fast solution. So now we should have a look at the laminate properties. If you select the laminate one, you can see here in the entity browser that we have a card image of stack. Okay, this is clear. We want to stack plies on top of each other. And then here we have this laminate option. This is the important thing here. For example, if I have a look here, we have, for example, symmetric. This is used for creating symmetric laminates. In our case, that would mean, okay, we're using symmetric. We defined 10 plies, and the solver automatic, or by choosing this symmetric option, the solver would use those 10 plies and reflect it here at ply 10 to create another 10 plies. Just out of convenience, we only have to define our 10 plies, for example, here. Then another option is smear. I'm going to explain it to you a bit more in the optimization part. And for now, I just want to use total. Total just means that we have exactly this stacking sequence we defined here. So we start at ply 1 and go to ply 10. The next thing to define would be the property. But before we do that, I would just want to explain one property to you. This is offset options we can choose in properties. For composite, it's really important to keep in mind that that we have this option. And if you import a geometry and you define, or if you modeled basically the geometry as a mid-plane, so basically you set your CAD the following, that you draw the mid-plane of your monocoque, for example, or your composite part, then by default OptiStruct would take the would start meshing at well would start meshing at ply one, of course, of your laminate, but the actual mid-plane of or yeah the actual mid-plane would be in between those 8 plies, so after ply four. I prefer using this bottom option with the option with the offset option set 0 is equal to 0, because then I can just define my inner surface, or I just create my inner surface by using CAD software, and then I just now okay, this is now my surface where my ply one is lying on. And then it's the other plies are stacked on top of each are stacked on top of ply one, then following the element normal direction. There's also the possibility to tell OptiStruct, okay, now I have defined my outer surface. I want to mesh to the inside, but my element normal direction is also defined to the outside. So please use my set zero option as minus t. Minus t stands for wall thickness. So t is the wall thickness, and then OptiStruct would recognize, okay, you want to start at ply eight, and you want to go down to ply one. So you define your laminate like this, that you start at ply eight and go down to ply one. Okay, then after knowing this, we can go back to Hypermesh and define our property. So back in HyperWorks, we can directly define our property by just right-clicking here the composite browser, create property. I say crop carbon, and then I go here in the entity browser, and you can see that HyperWorks by default already uses pcomp as card image. So it's not pshell or psolid or prot, what we had before. It's pcomp. Pcomp is a property for a ply-based property. A ply-based property is basically something close to reality. I would say it like this. That means that you really have ply shapes, like you're defining ply shapes here in HyperWorks, like you would slice plies out, like you would slice plies out in reality. So you have plies, you put them off to on top of each other, and then you do your vacuum infusion or whatever, yeah. And the same is done here in HyperWorks. We defined our laminate, and by saying, okay, we want to have a property with a card image pcomp, we are telling OptiStruct to look for a stack. And since our laminate is a stack, it knows OptiStruct directly knows, okay, I have to use the ply-based property. And what we have to do now is this set zero option, what I told you before, and I just use this set zero. I set it to zero so that my plies will be stacked in this direction up here in the set direction, because this is my element normal direction, beginning by ply one up to ply 10. That's it for this property. So I'm going to make this smaller. And then the next thing I want to show you are the material or the visualization tools. The first visualization tool I want to show you is the material reference orientation visualization. To have a look again at material reference orientation, you just can right click here on laminate or any of the supplies of this laminate. Right click and you say review orientation and you say material reference. And as you can see now, you will get a coordinate system for every element. And the red arrow is the fiber one direction. The green arrow is the direction perpendicular to the fiber one direction, and the blue arrow is basically the vector pointing out of the shell element. Yeah, as you this is a similar view to the element orientation view, but as you can see, all our red arrows are orientated in the same direction. This is because we referenced our material reference orientation on the x-axis of this local coordinate system. If you want to leave this material reference orientation visualization tool, just again right-click on laminate and say review orientation and untick this material reference. Okay, the next tool is the PLY1 direction visualization tool. To display PLY1 direction, you can just go to one of your plies here in the laminate, just right-click on it and say review orientations and to tick here PLY1 direction. Then you can see if you zoom in a bit that you'll get some arrows pointing in the x direction of our global coordinate system. This is because we defined our material orientation in that direction and we defined our ply orientation in direction 0. If you want to, or if you just go here and change the orientation of ply 6 to 45 degrees, you can see that now our fiber 1 direction is orientated 45 degrees to this material orientation we defined before. You can do this for every ply and go through every orientation and check if you modeled or if you set up your laminate right. I will just go here and change it back to 0 and then it should actually change. Okay, now it changed, yeah, perfect. And to deselect or to leave this tool again, you just right click again and apply on one of these plies and you go to review orientation and apply one direction. What's also useful, you don't have to do this for every ply. For example, you just get here review orientation, ply one direction. And then you go to the next ply and say, okay, please show me this ply one direction. You can do it interactively. If, for example, I do this 45, then you can just go to ply 5. Then you see the orientation of ply 5. And for example, here 90 degrees. Then so you can just go click through your model, through your laminate to see actually your ply orientations. Then I again leave this model. Review orientation. I leave this tool by just right-clicking and untick this tool. I now select all my plies and set the orientation for all plies to 0. And as you can see, the orientation for all plies changed now. The next thing we can do is we can visualize our ply shapes by just going over our plies here in the composite browser. You see that the edges of our shape are colored in the color of the ply. For example, here ply 5 has a color blue, and you see that the edge is blue colored if I just go with my mouse over those plies. Another way to show the ply shapes is to just right-click here on apply and say, okay, you want to review it, or just pressing Q on your keyboard. Then you can see the ply shape and the color of the ply, which is like this pinkish color now. If you would have another shape then full, you would see this shape, for example. I will demonstrate it to you now. I just click escape to leave this tool, and then I'm going to create a new shape, create shape. I just call it shape temporary temp. And then I select some elements here, for example, those elements, and by holding control, maybe those elements over here, I say okay. And for example, then for ply 6, I'm using my shape. If I go to the entity browser, I'm just selecting shape temp, for example. And if I click then on ply 5, right click review, you see ply 5. And then if I just switch to ply 6 by clicking on ply 6, you see that ply 6 has now the shape of this, has now this shape here. Okay, this was the demonstration of the ply shapes. I'm going to delete the shape temporary by just by click delete and assign the full shape again to ply 6. Okay, yeah, that's perfect. I'm going to save now just to make sure that everything is fine. Then we should go, before we start analysis, we should check the ply through thickness and layer visualization. To do that, we can make use of these tools here. You know them already from 1D meshing and 2D meshing of the plate before. If you click here on 3D, we should see our the thickness of the plate. But for some reason, the thickness is not displayed. So it's really good that we use this visualization tools to check our model before we start analysis, because obviously we didn't assign the property to our elements. To assign the property, this ply-based property to elements now, we just go here to this property, right-click on it and say assign. And now we can assign it to components or to elements. I'm choosing elements, for example, select all my elements here and click OK. And as you can see, now we have a ply thickness assigned to our plate. Now you can make use of the second button here, ply layers. And if you click on this, and then you can see that you are not able to only see the thickness of the whole plate, you also can see the layup. So basically we start with ply 1, then ply 2, and since we selected different colors here, you also can see that where your ply ends and where the next ply begins. And you also can make use of this tool here. If you just click here with the left mouse button on this ply symbol next to ply 6, you can highlight and now you can hide and show ply 6 by just clicking through it, or ply 10, ply 9, ply 8. You can just have a look at every single ply here. This these two visualization tools, as you have seen, we forgot to assign the property, so it was really important to check everything before we start analysis. Now everything should be checked, everything assigned, and now we can think about boundary conditions and loads again. I would like to just update my boundary or my single point constraints, and especially I want to update this edge here. I'm going to my model browser first of all and go to load collectors and open the displacement load collector. As you can remember from the metaplate, we forced this edge to move 0.85 5 mm in the positive x direction to achieve a nominal stress of 400 newton per millimeter square in our plate. If we want again to achieve a nominal stress of 400 megapascals in our composite plate now, we have to update this displacement since our E modulus is in since our E modulus in fiber one direction is smaller than the E modulus we defined. No, it's higher than the E modulus we defined for this aluminium. Aluminium we defined 70 gigapascals, and here we defined 110 gigapascals. So we have to lower the, or we have to decrease the displacement to achieve the same stress, since you know Hooke's law basically is sigma is equal to strain times E modulus. So if we have a higher E modulus, we have to have a lower strain to to achieve the same stress. To update displacement or boundary conditions in general, you can make use of this analyze. And this boundary condition ribbon, again, you can go to constraints. And as you already know, this constraint panel will open. In our case now, we just want to update the constraint. We just go here and untick all degrees of freedoms. We select our load now, just by drawing a window above over this boundary condition here. And then we say, okay, degree of freedom one should be 0.545 millimeters. If you click on update, you can say, okay, please update DOF, degrees of freedom, and say update. That's perfect, yeah. You can hit return. So since we have a composite plate now, we might want to evaluate stresses and strains in each ply. To do that, we just have to go to the load step, to our step one, and look for the, that is the output requests, and we can click here on see strain and see stress to request the strain and stresses in each ply. I just choose corner data again to also see corner data, so stresses and strains at the nodes. Okay, now we can actually start our analysis by just clicking here and on analyze and on display button here. We say that we want to save our model in a specific folder. We say save and then we hit Optistruct and wait for the solver to simulate. Everything was defined right. We get a maximum displacement of 0.545. This is basically the displacement we applied here. If I close this window now and open this split window, we can have a look at our results again. And okay, I just open this one here and open the results by just clicking here on open model. Open model, I open its composite sim plane, H3D apply, and I again show my mesh. This time mesh lines, then I'm looking from the top. I define displacement, for example, I want to have the X direction. I hit apply. Here on legend, I just define my legend, maybe 8 colors, and this should be gray again so that we have the same legend as before. And here I just typed in now 0.857 from before. There, if I hit the apply, you just see that Yeah, this is just for comparison with the metaplate. For comparison, it's always, I would say, needed, really needed that you have the same legend. And if you put those two, if you compare those two pictures now, you see that you see the difference in the displacement now. There's not only displacement we can have a look at, since we defined the output for, or since we defined that we want to have output on Bly level, we just can come here and say, okay, please show me the composite strain. You can change here from Mises strain to, for example, normal X strain. You can choose between all your plies, for example. I take ply 3 now as an example, and if I hit apply, you will see that nothing will be colored. This is because our legend is our numbers in our legends are too high. So I go back to edit legend, go here to this number, say delete on my keyboard, and hit apply now. Let's have a look at these trains. Yeah, these trains are kind of weird. If you think about it, we hold the plate at one side and pull at the other side, and normally we would expect equal strain over the whole plate. But think about it. We said in the property definition of this ply-based model that we have a set zero, so an offset defined, so that we basically start stacking the ply at the bottom and going from ply 1 to ply 10. That means on the other side that we are applying the boundary condition for the solver at this ply 1, and we also pull at ply 1. So that means that you have a different stiffness on top of the boundary condition and below the boundary condition, and that would lead into a bending of the plate. But since we are holding the plane in direction 3, you prevent it from bending, but you get different strain values over the plate, as you can see it here. And to avoid this, you would have to go back to the hyper mesh and say, okay, now if we don't want to use this property set zero, we want to go with the default option. And then we said, okay, this mesh we created here shouldn't be on the let's say inner surface of our laminate, it should be in the middle of the laminate. And with this default set zero, we would get the same laminate, but just with an at another position. And the boundary conditions on this edge and this edge would be applied on the middle of the laminate. And then, in principle, or in theory, we should get equal distribution of strain over every ply. Let's do this. Let's go back here to Hyper Mesh and go here to the composite browser, go to our properties, click on property carbon, and just delete here from zero. Here we had zero, and there we have to type in nothing, so the default value. Then we hit on OptiStruct and save our composite plate as set zero default. Click on save and run OptiStruct again. After a few seconds, we should get our results. I'm going back to Hyper View again to just prepare already the to go into the new model. Go to open, and I think it should be calculated. The analyze completed. I'm just going to open the H3D file, and then I'm going to use this, and maybe we are going to the top view again. Say we want to see composite strains at normal X strain and apply number 3. If you click apply, you can see that you have no constant strain over the whole plate because every value here is 4%, and if you look at the maximum strain and at the minimum strain in the whole model, you get also 0.4% strain. So I just want just showed you this this differences and the stress results to tell you that you have to be really careful with what you do in the analysis setup. As you saw, we just defined boundary conditions and the displacement, and we thought, okay, it's anyway okay, like we do it, and then we saw that the strain values are actually not what we would have expected. Just keep this in mind that you have to be really careful, and yeah, that's basically what I wanted to show you. The next thing we can have a look at is composite stresses. I keep imply 3, and now you see that we have composite stresses of around 400 megapascal. This was our value which we wanted to have, so this is also fine. Yeah, that's so far everything I wanted to tell you about this. Basically, 2D meshing and laminate creation or composite analysis. And now I would invite you for the next minutes to follow me when I'm explaining composite optimization to you.
So, thank you, Marius, for this introduction to composite simulation, composite modeling. And I think we didn't have too many questions in the tab. Sorry, I'm just started HyperWorks here. We didn't have too many questions in the tab so far. There was one question if you can animate the results, which you answered. Yes, of course, you can animate the results. So you can also create a video from your results. You can write out an AV or MP4 file. That's all no problem. I hope it got clear for everyone what Marius was doing is basically defining directions and layups is necessary for composites because you have different material properties in different directions, right? So a lot of the steps that were shown is really related to that, that in the fiber direction, you have a high Young's modulus, a high stiffness, while perpendicular to the fiber, you have a very low resin material, a very low stiff resin material. So that's why you need a different material property perpendicular to the fiber. And that's basically done by defining the normals, by defining the directions of the material, and then by defining the orientations in the different plies. So one big question that I have, but let's first ask you again, if you still have questions, please post them in the question tab. So feel free, just write your questions there and we'll answer them live. Now, what my question would be, Marius, from your experience, it's probably also a bit tricky to get the right material properties for composite fibers and resin materials. Can you tell the listeners how you did it, or how did you work in your projects to determine the right fiber material properties? I think you entered 110,000 as a Young's modulus, but where did you get that value from?
Yep, I hope everybody can hear me. Just to check. Okay, good. We did it, or we are doing it like this. We asked the manufacturers if they give us material data. You can find a lot of manufacturers on the internet, of course. Maybe also manufacturers where you order your material. But if it's not possible to get material data from them, usually a good thing is to do tensile tests and three-point bending tests. For example, tensor test, you can do it in fiber zero direction, so parallel to the fibers, then you can do it in perpendicular direction, or 45 degrees plus and minus to also get shear moduluses. That's, I know it's a lot of work, but if you want to have exact data, you have to do it actually.
All right, thank you. There's also a program that can help you a bit in using the test data and extract the right values for your solver. So that software is called Multiscale Designer. So in Multiscale Designer, you have the possibility to basically match your test results to your material model in OptiStruct. So that's basically, a way how you can use also another software to correlate between your test and your simulation results. Another thing that I would like to hint you to is, let me just stop my presentation here, is the Altair Material Database. So there's a website called materials.altair1.com/materials. So let me just open that. So here you'll find not only for composites, but also for a lot of steel and metal and plastic materials, you will find thousands and thousands of manufacturer entries here that you can use for simulation. So this is also a valuable source when you do simulation to get started with your material property values. And then there's another option, a software called ESACOMP. So ESACOMP is another program that you can download and install. Let me just see if I can show it to you. That also has another material database, especially targeted to composite values. So if you like, you can install ESACOMP as a student version, or if you have the full license, also the full version, and use the material database in there. All right, so that's the software here for analysis, design of composites, and including a material database. All right, so there's another question. There's a question to the same field. If you choose the area card in constraint UF1 and enter the same value of 0.545, can you please tell me what that means? Marius, I'm not sure if you would like to answer, or should I?
You can answer if you want, yeah.
Yeah, so let me just open here. I'm not sure if I can directly show it. I think the question is related to the constraint value that you enter here, and standard as a standard you have an SPC, which is you take a node and you lock it to zero movement. So a single point constraint is SPC. Now if you enter value here, that means you enter a pre-force displacement. So this node will move 0.54 units in the X direction. Okay, so it's a prescribed displacement that this node must move in the static analysis. Now there are other analysis types, not only static analysis. You can also, for example, an excitation at this point. So it's not a movement, a static movement, but it's an excitation. And for that, you can define the D area card, which means the node will be excited or have an excitation with a sinusoidal curve and a maximum peak of 0.545 units. So that's what the D area card is meant for. Okay, another question, how can we get the recorded videos? So let me just show you that again. So you have the student webinar series here where you registered on the website, right? So you went there and went to the student webinars, and here you can find all the recordings of yesterday, the day before, or last week. We haven't uploaded yesterday yet, but we'll do it soon, and we'll also upload the today's recordings. And if you go there, it will bring you to our YouTube channel. So this one will basically link directly, for example, to the aerodynamics video on YouTube. Now you get an advert, of course, before you see anything. But that's another channel or way to go directly to the Altair University channel, look at the videos, and then check for the latest uploads here. Okay? As we are approaching the end of the, or nearly the end of the advanced simulation track with the next presentation of Marius, I would like you to hint to another website. So there's the student webinar series, as mentioned, but there are more advanced topics that we didn't cover yet. So time is limited, but still we have lots of resources. For example, we have just recently had the English Simulation Academy with experts talking about Inspire Cast for casting simulation. We had experts talking about the eMotor Director, a way to design and simulate your eMotors in an efficient way. We have had a session on hyperstudy for optimization and parametric studies for EDEM and for math and scripting. So if you want to watch these, go to this link. I'll also post it in the chat. And then you can look at these nice fellows here, which are my colleagues of Altair Germany, who just did this series here and basically can give you, or you can watch these recordings as well, in addition to what we recorded in the student webinar series. All right, well, let me check for additional questions. Did we have anything else? I don't think so. The next topic is how to optimize the composite layout that you define. So final hour of the advanced simulation session. Next week, of course, you are invited to attend the data-driven session. So how to use all the data that you generate in simulation, but also in testing. You have like tons and gigabytes of data, how to use that to extract knowledge for your team or for your project. So that's next week's topic. But right now we are finalizing the agenda today with the optimization of a laminated profile and how to basically use simulation to determine the ply cutouts and the ply directions of your laminate. So that's, again, Marius speaking, and enjoy the rest of the session.
All right. Before we start with the optimization tutorial, I just want to repeat what I taught you in the topology optimization already, what actually optimization is. Optimization is basically an act, process, or methodology of making something as fully perfect, functional, or effective as possible. The general optimization problem can be defined as this, where f is the objective function. This is usually to be minimized. G are the constraint functions that must be satisfied in an optimization. Both of these functions, the objective function and the constraint functions, are functions of the design variable, and this can have lower and upper bound limits. There are m constraints and n design variables for any optimization problem. Exactly one response must be the objective function, or all other responses can be constraint functions. The classical approach in an optimization is the following. You create and analyze a design, and then in the next step, you interpret the results of your analysis. You think about updates for a new design, you apply those updates in your design and reanalyze your problem. Then you have a look at your updated design again and the results, and you proved that your updates were satisfying. If they weren't satisfying, you go back to the design and apply other updates. This is basically a never-ending story. Usually you do this in iterations, manually basically, so by hand. And if you are using OptiStruct, for example, the first thing you do is you create a finite element model. You define design variables, objective, and constraints. And then OptiStruct automatically evaluates the analysis results, defines updates for new improved designs, and finally returns to the analysis. Basically, you get I would say really useful design suggestion, which you can take to CAD and finalize it. Just for explanation, design variables are values that can be changed in the model. For example, the thickness of a plate in a so-called free size optimization, or the element density threshold in a topology optimization. Furthermore, next to design variables, we have responses. These are values that can be measured from a model, for example, the normal strain. Then we have constraints. Constraints are limits on the responses which must be satisfied for a feasible design. For example, the normal strain mustn't be greater than 1.5%. In the end, we just have to define an objective. An objective is a single response of the model which is to be minimized or maximized. For example, we can minimize the mass or we can minimize the compliance. So now let me tell you a few words about composite optimization. Basically, we define everything what you have seen before. We define design variables, we define responses, we define constraints and objective, also in a composite optimization. And what do we do in a composite optimization? We do composite free size optimization and composite size optimization. The goal of composite free size optimization is to find Bly shapes, which are the most efficient for our load case. And then we have the composite size optimization. There we want to answer the question of how many plies of each ply shape are required to satisfy the strength or manufacturing engineering requirements. To answer those questions, I would like you to open HyperWorks now and follow my steps again. All right, for this optimization part, I prepared a model file for you. It's a .fem file, so please import this by using the file manager, files, import solverdeck, and the name of this file is head.fm. You just click on reader opdestruct import, and then this head structure, it's basically a beam with something like a head as cross section. I will display the elements and okay, yeah, that's it so far. Yeah, let's have a look at the model browser. We only have one component. If I double click on this component, we see that we have only a mesh array level. Yeah, so no geometry, only a mesh. Then we have information about the number of elements and number of nodes. And that's basically it. So we have no no material, no property, no load collectors, no load steps, no so nothing we have defined here. Since this is a composite optimization tutorial, I will go through all the important steps of composite definition again, but a bit faster than in the introduction video of this composite plate. The first thing we always checked was the element normal direction. We did it in the composite browser. You say you go to model and you go here to composite ribbon, and then this composite browser will open. I will just close this component browser. And now we are back in this composite browser. The element normal direction, we can check if we go right click here on the in this white field somewhere in the composite browser, say element normal, then this orientation review will open. I pick my elements here. I just want to pick my elements. Okay, then I say, okay, please color display, and I say apply so elements. I have to select them. Okay. and then I click apply. And you see that this time, not all the elements are pointing in the same direction. I would like to have all element normals pointing out of this surface. So I close this window and go to element, say normals. And then I'm going to, I will be referred to this element normal panel. I say, okay, I'm changing to elements here. Orientation should be element. Then I say color display, I say display. And then I'm just choosing one element, which is red here. I have to deselect those elements. Then one element, which is red. Then I'm going back to elements, choose all elements and say adjust. And then every element is red colored. That means all normal vectors are pointing out now. This was the first thing we had to check. The second thing is that we have to define the material reference orientation. I click here return. Material reference orientation was done by right click here, say orient and material reference orientation. We have to select elements again. I choose all the elements here. Then scaling option, I leave auto, and then X direction method instead of using a local coordinate system. Now I'm choosing a curve. And instead of, since we don't have any geometry in our model, I am switching to nodes. Click here in this node field and by pressing, clicking one node here and by pressing Alt on my keyboard, I define a node path all to the end of this beam. This is here, then we have this over here and here and here. Okay, yeah. This, and if you click on apply now, and if you have a look here, you will see that our element, that our material reference orientation will now follow the curvature of this part. If you would have defined a local coordinate system, this wouldn't be the case. I hit cancel here because I'm done with defining the material reference orientation. And now I can go straight over to the orthotrophic material generation. We did it here in the composite browser. We said create material. Automatically, material card MAT8 is going to be created. And I can just rename my material to material carbon, for example. Then I type in my values. 203, 1, 3. Then this should be 7, 9, 30. Then I'm defining this with 0.34. G12 should be 3790 and 2760. And density should be 1.555 e minus this one, yeah. And then I'm also going to define allowable strain or stresses. In this case, I want to define allowable strains. I say, okay, tension strain in fiber direction should be 0.08. Then compression is 0.006. So 0.6%, then we have here a value like this. Then here we have something like 0.006 again, and 0.006 again for S, yeah. What we have to do if we define strains here, by default, if you type in some values here, these are allowable stress values. If you want to have these as allowable strain values, you just go here to strn and type 1.0 inside here. That means that these values are now allowable stress value. I'm sorry, allowable strain values. Good, our material is defined now. And the next thing we have to do is to create plies. So first thing is we have to create ply shapes. And on afterwards we create plies, then we create a laminate. To create ply shapes, we said we just right click here in the composite browser, say create and shape. I name it again shape full because I want to have all my elements as one ply. For the free size optimization, I just go here to element and select my elements over here. Say okay, we have 4920 elements now in this shape full. After defining the shape, I can create a ply. I just click on right click create ply. I say, okay, I want the orientation of 0 degrees. I want a thickness of 1 degree. I want my material I created before. And I'm choosing my shape. This should be the full shape, yeah? That's good for this, for now. Then I'm going to duplicate my ply 3 times in order to create 3 more plies. My prefix should be ply, and I want to create 3 more plies. And now we have to know what the free size optimization for composites actually does. We have to define plies with a specific ply orientation. Let's say we are defining now plies with 0 degrees, 90 degrees, 45 degrees, and minus 45 degrees. That means we are giving OptiStruct exactly these values, and we will get only plies with those angles back after optimization. Like I said in the introduction, with composite free size optimization, we will get proposals for ply shapes, but these ply shapes will have then these orientations we are defining here. So if you want to have more than 4 orientations, you should define more than 4 plies. Okay. I'm changing just the colors to get a bit to clean up my model a bit and to just to clean up my model a bit. And this one here, yeah. Good. Now we have 4 plies defined. I want to have different orientations, like I said, 90, 45, and minus 45. Material should be carbon for all of them, and all of them should have the shape full at the beginning, yeah. Just as a hint, I have a total laminate thickness of 4 millimeters now. This is just a value. This 4 millimeters I assumed. So basically, I did it like this. I modeled this part. Or I signed a steel material card for this part, applied the boundary conditions and the loads we will see later on this model, and just measured displacement. And then I manually changed the thickness of this structure here. And I came up with 4 millimeters because for steel material, the displacement, the overall displacement was in a good range. So if you have some structure you want to optimize and you don't know which values you should put in here, it's always a good idea to just model this with an isotropic material and just have a look at the displacements if they are way out of range. So I don't know, 10 millimeters, for example, for a small part is a value, I would say it's very out of range, but if you have a big part and 10 millimeters, then you have to think about it already, if this is good or not good. Just as a hint, yeah. Now we are going to create our laminate, just by right click, create laminate. This should be laminate one, and I just put my plies into this laminate. And the laminate properties, I am changing from laminate option total to smear. Smear is actually doing the following. This is with this option, we do not consider the stacking sequence of our laminate. So basically for optimization, for composite free size optimization, we are just interested in ply shapes. And so we are not interested in stacking sequence yet. This will follow later on, but for now we just switch off these influences of the ply position in our laminate. And this is done by stack, by smear. After this, we have to create our property. It's just right click, create property. I say prop carbon. And this time I again choose this set 0.0. So basically I'm saying, okay, this is a structure from CAD, I got it. And I'm modeling my elements on the inner surface. And since my element normals are pointing out, my laminate will be stacked from ply one, what you would see here, to the outside, to ply four in this case, yeah. And this set zero option, it's now this is the reason I'm using it like this now. And I'm also saying, okay, I will fix my hole, the whole end here will be fixed to a wall or something like this. And I only want the fixation here at this edge. And I will say, okay, I will treat it as welded and my welding seam is on the inside. Just as an example, yeah. Normally, of course, you might consider to weld it from both sides or maybe only from the outer side because you can reach it better. But for now, I'm just saying, okay, I just want it there. That's the reason I'm also putting here set zero. Okay, that's it so far with the property. Then we have to assign this property to those elements here. This is done by right click assign. Then we want to assign prop carbon to elements, and I'm choosing all the elements here and clicking OK. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, good. Then I will just have a quick look at my thickness if it was assigned. Okay, it was assigned. If I'm clicking here on plies and here on plies as well, yeah, I can see my different plies: ply one, ply two, ply three, ply four. That's good. It was defined like I wanted it to be defined, yeah. Perfect. I can just switch this off and switch this off. Then I might want to see material reference. Then I'm going here again and I see that my X direction of every element, so my really material reference orientation, is defined. That's perfect. And I switch this off by just clicking here on material references again. And okay, our laminate should be defined. And what we have to do now is that we want to fix all degrees of freedom at this edge here. So we create a load collector, create, not here in the model browser, we have to do it, right click, create load collector. I say just BC 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. I give it a nice color, like maybe something like this. And now I'm going to analyze ribbon, go to this, not to display button. This was wrong. I just want to go to boundary condition constraints. I want to create on nodes. I want to, this is just from before, from this metaplate, I want to constrain all six directions and node by path. Then I can just select three nodes here. And if I click on create, you see that the whole edge is now constrained in all directions. As I said, this is a classical boundary condition for a welded structure, because everything is constrained in every direction. Perfect, yeah. Now I want to create a load here on this edge here. I would like to create a load depending on the local coordinate system down here. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to create a local boundary, a coordinate system here, sorry, and define my load depending on this local coordinate system, okay. First thing we are going to do is we say, okay, I'm going to create a temporary node here in this middle. To do that, I'm going to the geometry panel, say here create point nodes. I'm changing here to nodes, and then I'm just putting with drag and drop. I go from one side to the other side, middle mouse button to accept, and now I have created my node. To now define a local coordinate system, I have to define the origin. We have it here. Then we have to define one axis and basically two axes. Then I'm going to translate this node now in the direction of this edge here. To do that, I'm going to use this move tool. I say move. I don't want to move nodes. I want to move nodes exactly. Then I'm going to press the shift button on my keyboard and move this move tool to this lower point here. And then I'm orientating by drag and drop the Z axis to this point over here. So you can see that the move tool is now fixed to this edge, and this Z axis of this move tool is lying on this edge. So if I say no X axis, for example, and 5 millimeters, my node will be translated 5 millimeters in this local set coordinates. Yeah. With the mouse button to accept, and then I just create again a new node, and I'm going from here to here. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Then I have this node now select. Now I have two nodes, and now I can create my coordinate system. To create a coordinate system, we just go again to model systems over here. We want to create a rectangular local coordinate system. We want the origin here. I want my y-axis here, and I want my yz plane here. And if you click create, your local coordinate system is created, and you can see that your y-axis is pointing to in this direction, z-axis is pointing in this direction. I click on return, and I'm going to delete those two nodes, and then I'm just giving the system collector another color. Let's say something like this, and I call it system load. Okay, yeah. If I want now to define a load, I can go to, I have to create a load collector first. I say here in the model browser, create load collector. I call it load force there. Then I'm going to the analyze ribbon again, go here on apply forces. Then here I have the possibility to create forces on nodes. This is exactly what we want to do. But we don't want to apply a magnitude. We don't want to apply the force based on the global system. We want to apply it based on the local system. I just select my local system, and we don't want to apply a magnitude. We want to apply a load depending on an equation. And this equation should be based on the z-axis, and the equation should be 0.25 times absolute of 2 times y. And what does this do? We have this coordinate system now. So basically, if we are taking this point, this equation takes the y value, depending on this coordinate system, and multiplies it by 2, takes the absolute value of this, and divides it by 4 again. Now we just have to define our node path where we want to apply these forces and hit create. And as you can see, you get a non-equal force over the length, and yeah, basically you get the same force here, you get it here, yeah. And here where the y value is not changing, you get everywhere 6.25. I hit return, so my load is now defined. And then I'm able to define my load step already. I just go here to this view and click here create load step. And I'm going to define my step one. Yeah, I again want to do linear static. My boundary condition or single point constraint is this one here. My load in this case is this one over here, load force. And then I just go to the output and I want to request C-strain. Again with corner data, stress with corner data. I want to have displacement. Last but not least, I want to have I want to request C failure, and this is fine. And since I'm defining or requesting C failure, I have to go back to my composite browser, go here to property carbon, and here you can see the failure theory. And if you open it, you can see that you have the failure hill, I think, Saihu. Then you have the maximum strain, which I was talking about. And I'm going to choose maximum strain. And now we are ready for analyzing. My recommendation is that you analyze every part you want to optimize before you optimize it. The reason for this is just to check if you have displacements up in the sky, or if something is unlogical, if you have defined everything right as it should be. To run the analyzers, I just go to run here, say okay, I save it somewhere, say run option analyzers, and hit obdestruct. This might take a few seconds now, and if we have done everything right, this will be again, of course. Fine, I'm opening Hyperview already on the second screen, and have a look at my displacements then. Good, this is completed, this is fine. I close this, we don't have any warning or error messages. So I'm going here to Hyperview and open my model file, or my result file. I'm going to open it. It's not here, it's here in head and head 3D. Then I just do this one time and this to have this back. And now I can see if I go to displacement and say, okay, please show me the magnitude that we have a displacement of around 2.15 millimeters here. Yeah, this is for me a logical value, because if you think about this, this part is quite long, and if you press here with a force, this is this really can be that you deform it 2 millimeters. Yeah, I just say here, I just want to check something else. I click apply and okay. I'm showing my mesh, and then I'm going here to result type and say I want to have composite failure index. I'm saying here failure index, and I click on apply. And then you can see that my composite failure index is way below one. So this first by failure criteria work like this. If you have a value between 0 and 1, your ply is, or your plies are, or your plies meet the first ply failure index. If the value is above one, they don't meet this failure index. But be careful, this is just the first ply failure index. Even if you get a value below one, your part still can break. It's just a good orientation you can follow to also request failure index, yeah, indexes, yes. If you go here to composite failure, you can also go to every ply and you click on apply, and you can see the failure indexes for every ply on its own. That's cool, yeah. So I will just close this post-processing window, because everything should or everything is working fine. I'm going back to HyperMesh and start with the optimization. Good, I make this window again 1. Okay, and close this here. Then, okay, yeah. Optimization, like we have seen yesterday already, we go here on optimize, and here on this optimized ribbon, we can go to the optimization browser. As said in the introduction, we want to do a composite free size optimization. That means we can click here on free size. Here we can define a name for our free size optimization, and configuration is free size, of course. Entity type, it's not a P shell, it's a stack now. And if we choose a laminate here in the list of laminate, we will see that this window here is getting quite big. These are all manufacturing constraints we can enter here. As I said in the topology tutorial, at the beginning, it's better to start with as less as possible constraints. So I usually start with min-dim, and I type in 10 millimeters here. The average element size of what we have here in this model is 5 millimeters. So min-dim is forcing, or OptiStruct is forcing the, or min-dim is forcing OptiStruct to create ply shapes with at least a width of 10 millimeters, so at least 2 elements. The next thing I want to do is this balance option. We have defined 4 plies with 4 different angles. By default, OptiStruct is creating 4 design proposals, or 4 different ply shapes for each angle. And since we defined 4 plies, we would get 16 different ply shapes after or during composite free size optimization. We can group specific angles together so that we reduce the number of created ply shapes. For example, we can group 45 degrees and minus 45 degrees, and so we would reduce the number of ply shapes from the number of different ply shapes from 16 to 12. I click close, and then my design variable, which defines values that can be changed in the model. Yeah, in our case, that would be the ply shape. The next thing we have to create are responses that are values that can be measured from a model. In our case, I want, or usually at the beginning, I start with a volume fracture response and a compliance response. Volume fracture is I want to constrain, basically later on in the next step, I want to tell OptiStruct, okay, hey, OptiStruct, I have here a part with a specific volume. Please only use, for example, 30% of this volume to create a proposal design. And this is what I'm going to do with this volume fracture here, what I'm defining now. Volume frac. And this is a volume fracture here. Just go here, volume fracture for response type, and that's okay, yeah? The second response I'm using for my objective, because in every optimization, we have to define exactly one objective. This is the overall goal of the optimization. In this case, I always start with compliance. The compliance is the inverse of the stiffness. So if I say, okay, please minimize my compliance, I tell this as objective. That means that the stiffness of my overall part will be maximized. So we have basically a maxim. We tell OptiStruct, okay, please take only 30% of this volume here and make the stiffest structure as possible out of it. This is done with those two responses here, yeah? Constraints, we said, okay, we want to create a constraint. This should be our volume fracture, volume frac. And we define a response here. We said this is response volume frac. Then we say we want to have an upper bound, and I will set it to 30%, yeah? That's good, and fine. You can see here in the optimization browser that you have now a constraint, you have one design variable, and you have two responses. Now we have to define the objective. We just click here on objective, say, okay, objective is min compliance, so maximize the stiffness, objective type is minimized, and we say, okay, please minimize the compliance. And we have to select our load step, and I say, okay, and I say close. So basically everything is defined now. And in order to create a Hypermesh database, right, we are doing optimization so that we can load the design proposal into Hypermesh again. We can ask OptiStruct to create us a .fem file, so a solver deck file. This is done by clicking here on Analyze. And if you go here on Analyze on this opening, you will be, no, not on this, on this play button, sorry. You will be directed to this Analyze panel again. Yeah, now it's opening. And you hit Return, and here on Analyzes, you can go to Control Card. And here you go on Next, until you see output. It's here, yeah? And I want an output from basically, this output should be free size to size. I see it here, free size to size. And this means, okay, we are doing a free size optimization and we want an input file for our size optimization. I hit return and return. Then I'm going to my optimize ribbon and click here on play by on optimize. I'm saving my component or my optimization under new folder. This is head opt. I save it. Then I'm changing from run options analyzes to optimization and hit opt-destruct. So after a few seconds or minutes, we get the answer that the optimization has converged and we got a feasible design that all constraints were satisfied. You can see here that it took opt-destruct 7 iterations to find an optimal solution. And I'm going to close this window now and save my model. Then I will open a new HyperMesh database by just clicking here new and import the result of this composite free size optimization. Go here file import solver deck. I'm going to go here this head sizing 7. 7 stands for iteration 7.fem. And I open it, I say reader opdestruct and the rest should be left as it is. And then I just can rotate it a bit and go to my composite browser and have a look at my laminate. As mentioned before, opdestruct is, or during composite free size optimization, opdestruct is creating four individual ply shapes for every ply orientation. You can have a look at those ply shapes by clicking here on this ply and click Q on your keyboard. And then it's the same as if you would click right click and review. And if you click through the plies, you can see all your ply shapes. You can see then if you go to ply 3200, so 3 stands for orientation 3, ply, and then this 2 stands for ply shape number 2. And if you compare this with the one ply 4200, you will see that it's the same. This is because of the balance option we have used in the manufacturing constraints by defining the design variable at the beginning of optimization. You can, of course, go and you can leave this tool, this review. And if you want, for example, now I go to this ply 1300 and say, okay, I go to shapes and say 1300 and I go to this elements and then you can see the elements you have here in your ply shape. If you want to add or remove elements, you can do it inside here. This is not a problem. And yeah, this is basically what you can do here. What's nice is that we already have ply shapes now, and the next step is the size optimization. So in the size optimization, the ply shapes wouldn't be changed anymore. That means that we already can, well, in the size optimization, it's only this the number of plies per ply shapes, which is important then. But that means that we already can, for example, take one shape here. Let's say we want to take shape 1300, say isolate here. And okay, maybe not this one because there we have this region in front of here. This is one of the shapes I would maybe update a bit by hand. I would just take here a bit more elements to define this shape. Just wanted to show something else. If I go here to isolate, maybe really 3500. I'm just looking for a ply shape. Okay, yeah, this is nice. You see, we have this ply shape 3200. Basically, we have a big shape here, and we have two, or basically one side shape here, which is going all the way here. You might want to create a geometry data out of it, and I just want to show it to you. I'm opening panels and go here to geometry. And if you go here to surfaces, you can create here from FE. So if you select those elements right over here and click create, you will see that hyper or the hypermesh is creating a surface for you out of these elements which are saved in Ply 3200. If you now go to the composite browser, for example, double click here on the com not composite browser, components browser, and hide the mesh, you can see that you have created geometries here, so a surface. This surface you can export you can export a step file, for example, and you can open it with CAD software. And in this CAD software, you can, for example, change these structures here that you don't have the sharp edges there, that you have a nice radius, for example, here. And yeah, then you can go back to HyperWorks, import your newly created shape, and start the definition of laminate again. For now, I just wanted to show you how to create surfaces out of mesh data. This is fine for now, and yeah, the last step is now the composite size optimization. Okay, now please go to the composite browser and have a look at the ply thicknesses here of each single ply. Since the purpose of the composite free size optimization is finding efficient ply shapes, we didn't care a lot about ply thicknesses. But for now, as you know, nobody has those ply thicknesses available at all. So we are going to change a few values. To do that, I'm going to the optimization view and go here to design variables, and you can see that now 16 new design variables were created, each for the thickness of each of the ply shapes. If you click here on FSTOSZ, so free size to size, then you can see that you have an initial value. This is basically the ply thickness, the current ply thickness, a lower bound and an upper bound. And we now have to change the upper bound to actually to a number which is actually manufacturable, or which is like yeah, just a logical number, so not a number with I don't know how many digits, just one digit, and this should be enough. This has to be done for every single ply. I'd say this is now 0.3, for example. This upper bound should be greater than the initial value, and now the task would be to go through all the values here. Yeah, here for example 0.5 then. And in the next one, we also go 0.3, for example, and so on. Then this one here is, for example, 0.1. I just choose a way larger than the initial value. Then in 5, we have again 0.2, or also 0.1. 0.1, yeah. And in 6 we have, let's say, 0.2. And 7 we have 0.7, yeah. Then in 8 this also should be greater, so 0.1. Then also 0.1. Then this is 0.2. Then in 11 we have 0.7. Then 12 is 0.1. 0.1. 13 is 0.1. This is 0.2. And this is 0.7. So now we changed all the upper bounds to a logical value, or to a value which is which doesn't have many digits. So basically an upper bound which can basically be manufactured. Manufactured is a good point for the next step. We have to define manufacturing constraints on our plies now. This is done here in the composite browser. And if you click on one of the plies and go to the entity browser, for example, you can see here that you have the manufacturing thickness for plies, yeah? You can change these values to values you, or to numbers you have available. For example, in your workshop, let's say you have ply thicknesses of 0.1, 0.3 millimeters and 0.5 millimeters. At home, you can just change the manufacturing thickness to those ply thicknesses. For example, I just can mark all plies and just say, okay, I have a ply thickness, I only have plies with a thickness of 0.25 millimeters in my workshop, and then this is taking into consideration. And now if we run the size optimization, OptiStruct will find the optimal number of every ply shape we have to create to satisfy all our constraints. Before I'm going to do my size optimization, I'm going back to my optimization browser and define new responses, new constraints, and new objectives. I'm going to delete my old responses, say delete entities. We don't have any constraints, and our design variables are the ones we treated before. I want to have a new response. This should be response static displacement. Okay, here I'm looking for static displacement. We have to define two nodes which shouldn't move more than a specific value. Then I'm going to say, okay, they shouldn't move in direction 3. Of this coordinate system, so I'm just choosing this coordinate system here and say close. Okay, then I'm going to create a second response. This should be response mass, because I want to reduce my overall mass. This should be my objective. Constraint, as I said, this should be static displacement. Response is static displacement. The response load steps is step one. And I want an upper bound of 2.5 millimeters. Yeah, I say close. And now I have to define my objective. This should be objective mass. I want to reduce my overall mass. And minimize response ID is mass. I click OK. Close, and in order to generate a hypermesh model again, or a .fem model, I'm going to analyze this again, control cards to output, and I'm changing from free size to size to size to shuffle, return and OptiStruct, and then I hit OptiStruct. So after a few seconds and three iterations, we get the message that the optimization has converged. We got a feasible design, which means that all constraints were satisfied. I close this, then I save this database. This was size to shuffle, size to shuffle. And I'm opening a new HyperWorks database, import my newly created solver deck. This should be no size to shuffle. This should be head shuffling.f3.fm import. And if we go now to our standard view here and go to the composite browser and go to laminates, you see that now all laminates have a thickness of 0.25 millimeters. And you see that, for example, of that we have now how many plies? It's we have 17 plies, 17 shapes. And if you want to see the shapes, you would just click on review orientation or the review, and then you go through the shapes. And of course, those shapes didn't change. And you just can click through the plies, yeah. So basically now we have the number of plies we need for this load case here with all the constraints we have defined. You see that now it's proposing us 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 plies in zero direction, 1, 2, 3, 4 plies in 90 degrees, in 45 degrees, and 4 in minus 45 degrees. Usually you would go through the plies now and sort them in your laminate so that the bigger plies, so the full ply shapes basically are at the outer sides of this part, and the smaller ply shapes like these ones here, for example, if you hit Q, these should be somewhere in the middle of your laminate. If you think of it, if you apply loads on your structure and your laminate is deforming a bit, it could be that you directly get delamination if those little plies are at the outside of your structure. Furthermore, you could think about adding several more plies to the structure just to protect the main structure. Usually you can create new ply shapes and say, okay, I want on my outer skin, I want plus or minus 45 degrees. And this you can also do here in this laminate. So I hope that I was able to explain you a lot. I hope that you learned a lot. I know this topic is quite difficult, but just give it the time. You will come into this topic of finite elements, of simulation, of optimization, of composites. Just give it a few days, weeks, months, and then you will be able to define to design breathtaking structures. Thank you very much for listening to me. It was a pleasure for me to be part of this Altair webinar series 2021. If you have any questions, just ask them. We are happy to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you, Marius, also for your presentation. And yeah, I hope you enjoyed it. So we didn't get, again, too many questions. If you still have questions, of course, type them in the chat. one question that came up was, as Marius addressed at the end, how can you get started and how can you get knowledge in this topic? To be honest, is this quite an advanced simulation topic even for a lot of industrial professional users? So composites is definitely a topic where you still can basically learn a lot. And if you learn it during your studies, you'll already have probably an advantage over many industry users. So what we can suggest to get further information is, again, visit our website, altairuniversity.com. We have ebooks there. So you can go there and download our free ebook on composite simulation, which will give you again a bit of background on the theory. And we also have ebooks on lots of other topics on 3D printing, on motion analysis, on wave propagation, stuff like that. So lots of information there to get started with the simulation, with your simulation topic that's most interesting for you. Okay. So that's definitely a recommendation to go on the website, download the student version, but also download the ebooks and get started from there. Of course, you learn more as you proceed through your studies and maybe work on projects. So if you are, for example, in a Formula team or in a Baja competition team, you can already start designing your first composite parts, for example. Or if you are in aerospace engineering, you probably will learn a bit more about this topic as it's more common in that discipline as well. All right. So I just saw there was another question. How do I change the ply from plane weave to twill weave? Marius, can you comment on that? Do you know some background on this?
Yes, usually these things I showed to you in this webinar is used most of the time for unidirectional plies, of course. Yeah, so basically plane, a plane ply. Twill weave is way more advanced, and I handle it like this. I also tried it out once. I just define two unidirectional plies. So for example, 0 degree and 90 degree and put them on top of each other. And of course, this twill is not considered there, but in my testing, it was not so important for the things I wanted to see. I hope that answer is satisfying. Your question. If not, then you can come back to us again.
Yeah, I would agree with Marius that the woven or twilled weaves are usually modeled the same way, although it is some sort of error that you make, but that's usually quite neglectable. But if you're interested in detailed simulation of twill weaves, there's also, again, specialized software where you can really do like a 3D simulation of your weaves, in case you need to really look into detail into your material there. Okay. So thanks again, Marius, for your presentation. Thanks for everyone who listened and who stayed until the end. So if you leave, give us a feedback in the survey that you will get upon leaving. You'll also get a reminder of the survey in a follow-up email, and in the follow-up email, you also should get a certificate. So thanks for joining today. Thanks for joining for the whole advanced sessions, and hope to talk to you next week when we speak a bit more about data analytics and how to use big data for your engineering projects. So thanks a lot and have a good day and enjoy the rest of your day and talk to you soon. Bye.